welcome. And we're live again at DACS, this time from Riva. And we're live with a specific question. And it's quite a simple question: who owns the art world? And to answer that, what we're going to do is we're going to have three presentations, one from Richard Parry, one from Hayley Newman, and one from Morgan Quaintance. And they come from very particular positions, and I think you'll be able to understand what those positions are after the presentation. But essentially, all three of them share a shared discursive concern with that question of ownership, and also not only the ownership of the art world in a conceptual and a material sense, but also what the role and agency of the artist is, and indeed art in that context. And we're asking that in the context of DACS, as an organisation which has a 30-year history of thinking about what artists can do to empower themselves and support each other, what a network looks like, feels like, and acts like. So with no more chit-chat, I'm going to hand over to Hayley.
So thank you very much for inviting me this afternoon. I'm speaking as an artist who worked with the collective Liberate Tate to get Tate to drop its sponsor VP. Liberate Tate is a feminist queer-led group formed of a core of around 12 people with up to 500 members who took part in performances and disseminated work on social media. Over the time that we worked together, we developed a form of non-binary art activism, one that did not privilege art or activism. We were a group and we were made up of artists, art historians, designers, hairdressers, NGO workers, and food growers. Our collaboration involved letting go of specialist knowledge, working and learning together, as well as using our specialisms when needed. We argued that there should be no oil sponsorship of museums and galleries in a time of climate change. And we were asking Tate to drop BP, the third largest contributor to global warming, and redraw an ethical line. In 2010, during the Gulf of Mexico oil spill, and in advance of a Tate summer party and celebration of Tate's 20-year-long relationship with BP, a sign-up letter asking Tate to drop BP was circulating. I signed and forwarded it to friends, including a Tate trustee, who sent my request on to Nicholas Sirota's office. I received a reply from the office and wrote an email to Nick Sirota saying I thought it was unethical for Tate to take this money. Later, I went to speak with the same trustee at a public event. He was scathing of the performances at the summer party. He also said artists had no power to change Tate policy and that what was needed was to change public opinion. From 2010, we began to articulate why it was unethical to take money from oil companies and to engage in a public debate about ethical lines and the conflict between public good and a sponsor's agenda. Between 2010 and 2016, Liberate Tate made 16 unsanctioned performances in the Tate galleries. We used live art methods such as rehearsals and rituals to frame and give our protests a defined start and end. A core element of our argument was that sponsorship gives companies a social license to operate. A social license to operate is not about oil companies selling more petrol, but gives corporations access to buildings, elite cultural groups and tastemakers, cultural commentators, artists and academics who shape wider opinion. Each performance posited a different argument. In The Gift, we installed a wind turbine blade, a gift of renewable energy, in the turbine hall of Tate Modern. In Hidden Figures, we played the parachute game with a giant black square and drew attention to the redacted minutes we received in response to requests that Tate reveal the amount of money it was receiving from BP. In Timepiece, we occupied the floor of Tate Modern with words from books on climate change, art, and activism. All of these works were photographed, videoed, and disseminated online as they happened. Our unpaid work also included giving talks, running workshops, editing the publication Not If But When, Culture Beyond Oil, commissioning a guerrilla audio tour of the Tate galleries, and supporting the organisation platform in their tribunal to get Tate to answer a number of freedom of information requests that would reveal the amount of money it was given by BP, which turned out to be an average of $224,000 per year between 1990 and 2006. less than 1% of Tate's income. To do this, we worked with many others, including the Art Not Oil Coalition, sister organisation Platform, as well as PCS union members within the museum sector. BP still sponsors the British Museum and National Portrait Gallery, and while BP no longer sponsors Tate, the gallery has not formally adopted an ethics policy with regard to oil sponsorship. We set out to get Tate to drop its sponsor BP and to redraw the line regarding sponsorship and ethics. At the start, I thought it would take 6 months, but it took 6 years. We felt public opinion shifts starting to change in 2015 when we performed Timepiece, and after a final push with the work Birthmark, we won in 2016. 10 years ago, this would have been unimaginable. We undertook a local campaign focused on Tate, which was situated within wider cultural and political contexts. Through this process, we explored different modes of protest and combinations of art, activism, and campaign work, and created a platform from which to raise public consciousness around climate change and the devastating impact of oil companies on human rights, our environment, and the climate. Everyone draws a line somewhere, and there is huge public concern about climate change, and people got behind us. Liberate Tate currently intends to publish a book on our work, provisionally titled Insides, Outsides. Through the book, we hope to reflect on how, along the surface of an imaginary Mobius strip, we took positions both inside and outside the gallery. This was one of the tactics that enabled us to drive a wedge between Tate and BP and end their relationship.
So, after Hayley, we may hear from Richard.
So I thought the art world is kind of like a boring or a fake category and something that I don't really know what we're talking about. So I asked Mark earlier if I could just talk a bit about an essay I wrote recently and then maybe just say something about the art I try and do a bit, and he said yes, so I'm just going to dive into that. The essay that I wrote is called London, London, and it explains how property developers linked with tax evasion, tax avoidance, externalising foreign currency, mineral smuggling and human rights violations conflate their private property investment portfolio with a collectively owned art collection in order to operate in London in a more intense or successful way. The sort of outcomes of these operations that I researched include things like Arts Council funding being transferred directly to an offshore investment vehicle owned and operated by the same director of an art foundation / real estate company who invoiced herself an unqualified £100,000 premium and successfully submitted the invoice to the Arts Council for payment. And it's funny you mentioned Nicholas Sirota, because when I wrote a sort of letter to the Arts Council asking a bit more about this after the Freedom of Information request, he must have been on his boat or something, so I didn't really get a reply. The second thing on this list of three is outcomes: unvalued leases on public buildings being acquired at half their subsequent book value and operated as investment properties by directors of an offshore registered real estate company. And the other outcome on this list is, which is quite weird, is that directors of an offshore registered real estate company are able to advise the Mayor of London on, in their words, protecting artists from the market activities that they themselves are sort of simultaneously undertaking. And these activities sort of result in public libraries becoming commercial studio spaces for artists that cost them 370% more than comparable studio provision models in libraries such as Lewisham Art House, big up to them. The essay uses processes of astroturfing to describe how artists are used to sell the activities of an offshore registered real estate company to the state, as appearing to originate from or be supported by a grassroots community when this is not necessarily true. It also uses associated processes of open cast mining in Zimbabwe, Zambia and the Congo to describe institutionalized extraction of cultural capital and how for artists in London these sort of processes abolish any kind of pre-existing context or natural stuff. So yeah, you can read the article in the current May journal or by going on my website. There's a link from the footer. Yes, that's what I wanted to say about the essay. Is that 5 minutes?
That's a good starter. Yeah?
Yep.
Sweet. I don't really have a presentation, and what I'm going to do, I thought would be better if I just followed on from what Hayley was saying, what Richard was saying, because obviously Liberate Tate was actually one of the, all of that stuff was one of the things that really, well, inspired me when I was sort of coming up through the art world as a bit of a puppy, and then now that I've matured and have seen some of the cracks, it's sort of informed my approach, I suppose. And so, yeah, I don't know. I'm just going to say what I'm thinking. And I think when Jelaine invited me to do this, I was like, I have no interest in having this conversation. We know who owns the art world. It's not me. And the people who own it aren't really going to... Okay, so maybe we should qualify things a bit. So when you say the art world, people say, oh, that's just an abstraction, doesn't really mean anything. But we all know, right, the art world, we probably can have a good batch at advertising what that might mean. So for me, the art world is obviously museums, galleries, magazines, journals, markets. So it's these institutions, and it's also the ideologies and the individuals that animate them. For me, that the term art world is the collective term for that system. And obviously, I'm not in the position to set the agenda for that system. So maybe in terms of ownership, I'm thinking about who can set the agenda, who can control the homogeneity or not of the art world, who decides whether or not the instrumentalization of art by government is okay, who else also decides, this is my third point, to capitulate to the real or imagined whims of private finance. It's not me. So obviously I don't own it. So what I'm really interested in is like, what are you going to do about it? What are you going to do about it? That's the thing. And I think Hayley and Richard are showing the way that it works on one level, and it involves a lot of personal sacrifice, it involves a lot of time and energy, emotional strain to get things done, and to do all of this work for kind of quite small results. So it took 6 years to get Tate to sort this stuff out, and then at the end of it, I'm sure people pretend as if the idea of disconnecting art and oil was just this natural concept that was in the air. But actually, you're the ones who've authored this discourse. And I think that's what always happens with political movements or any type of activism, is that people do all this groundwork, suddenly the conversation gets some air, but then you're not given credit for doing all the work. And so everybody who's watching it also thinks, oh, there's no movement, everything we do is futile, nobody listens. So I think that's a myth that I think needs to be busted. Effort does pay off. But I also feel like there needs to be some work. There needs to be some stuff from you guys. Like you guys, and no disrespect, I don't really know you, but obviously you're luminaries of some kind. So, you know, it's just like, what are we going to do? What are we going to do? You know, because all that's happening at the moment is this, I was talking about it in an article I wrote a while ago, and I was saying, I'm sick of the engage and reform. We're all trying to engage with the institution to reform it, with the idea being that if they just learn about homophobia, sexism, racism, then maybe they'll turn the corner and not be doing those exploitative behaviours. And as if that's going to be the case. We've been doing it for 20, 30 years and we're still in this situation. And it's become exacerbated by the global financial crisis of 2008, obviously. And it's just becoming more harder to ignore, more difficult to sort of pretend that this is the status quo. So I think, pretend that this is sort of, that there's no alternative. So really, what the only reason why I was like, I'm up for doing this is because I just want a chance to say, yeah, what are you going to do about it? What are we going to do about it? And like, we need to build some sort of other system. And I don't mean like, okay, how do we club together and buy an institution? I don't mean how do we club together and do a magazine?
or how do we do some knots? Obviously, everyone's going to have to think about it. And the thing is as well, not everyone's going to want to do it, and that's wicked. If you don't want to do that, if you think the best way to do things is to be like, no, I'm going to engage with freeze, the best way to do it is write articles for freeze because I can change discourse from the inside. You live that dream if you want to. In the same way that people think I'm going to engage with organisations like Create because, do you know what, they've got the resources and access to sociologists who are doing work on social mobility and that's the way I'm going to make a change. Yeah, you do that, you go for that. But for me, the real thing is going to be elsewhere and that's what I'm interested in. For example, I just came from a place called Sophia House that's down the road at the moment. It's being occupied by an organisation called Streets Kitchen and it's full of homeless people. And I'm sick of doing this. I'm sick of operating in a creative world where I go to somewhere like that and people have no food, no clothes. I drop off some clothes, I come here, I have a discussion in Reba about this. Like what, this is, and like it doesn't need to be this way. All of this food here, what, I know disrespect to you guys, I know it's just a fun thing, but why? Why is that there? Hopefully I can just take it afterwards and give it to someone. Because I just feel like, I just want some robust activity to happen and we've all got minds, we've all got stuff that we can do. I don't have a solution, but somehow we need one. What's happening already is this approach, what Hayley's doing, what Richard's doing, what I'm trying to do with research and that's covered, but we haven't got the energy to keep doing it. We haven't got the energy, we need like other people to help. It's like there's this case of a guy who was like, I was reading a book about tax evasion. I think it's called, I can't remember what the book was, but anyway, they were talking about this guy who was chasing after two brothers, someone who knows a bit more about tax history, or know more about his narrative than me, I might be getting it wrong. I think they were called the Vesties, and they were like the first people who were really taking advantage of the Duke of Westminster ruling and taking liberties. And basically, this guy pursued them for so long, so doggedly, and eventually nothing happened to them, and he killed himself. And I thought, yeah, that's the price. That is the price that we pay. You just get more and more depressed. So basically, we're up for it. We're going to make this happen. I don't want to, I'm not trying to talk to you, but I feel like this is maybe a generally acknowledged phenomenon. If you try and do something a bit different, it's a thankless task, really. And I think it's now time. Please, just... And if people are watching the stream, whatever, we need to do something other than engaging and reforming. And I'm not saying it's an either or. They're not mutually exclusive. We can do other stuff, but we need something else to happen also. So yeah, that's my 5-minute provocation.
Thank you very much. Just before we go towards what actually might be able to do, I think I'd just like to pedal back a little bit and just talk about what the risk of actually doing things up is. Because I think they're hearing from both Richard and Hayley, and I guess, Morgan, for you to some degree, there is a real risk in being the voice, the person, the body, the organisation, the thought behind that passionate decision to take the risk. And I'm really curious about actually how you feel having come on the other side of that, and what kind of real pressures you're put under in order to take that risk. So I'm thinking particularly from an artist's point of view, in terms of kind of the sustainability of an artist's career, there are all kind of issues about market sustainability. And so how you look at that relationship about your market sustainability and how that converges or otherwise with your ethical and aesthetic concerns, and how, having been through a process of making a stand, making an aesthetic stand, and making a stand in public about what you think is important. What kind of pressures have you been under? So maybe Richard, you could.
Not really that much. I mean, it's like this idea of risk and taking these, it's like Indiana Jones or something. It's not really like that. It's like, it's actually quite boring. It's quite like clerical. It's like admin work. It's like the stuff I do at Lewis Smart House. It's just incredibly tedious, but it's important, and that's, I don't have a problem with that. And it's not that sort of art world thing that's sort of sexy and cool and transmittable. Going back to the essay thing, I wrote the essay, and then the risk is like these kind of crusty Marxist artists wanting to be friends with you.
Interesting. I think that from your point of view, I suppose the illusion Mark has in terms of the territory it occupies, it's a territory which is, comes from spiral tribe, it comes from all of the stuff that Quaintance is talking about people just taking over space, living a life absolutely outside of the mainstream, and just saying, this is what we do. And it's a kind of style of dealing with capitalism, which is quite, you know, very vibrant and has long-term repercussions. You, as someone occupying that space with the kind of the capacity to do the research and do the bureaucracy, have taken on that mantle in a very different kind of way. And I guess the obvious thing that you that then becomes, you know, I suppose you get pigeonholed as a troublemaker, you know, someone who is making that happen in public. But you know, it doesn't feel like a problem. That's great. That's a good thing. Yeah. I'm not trying to say that everyone should be frightened of doing it.
Yeah.
I'm just kind of conscious about the people, again, going back to what Quinn says. You've done it, and people should be really grateful that you've actually crossed over that line. And I'm just interested to hear. And so, you know, maybe from you, Hayley, if there's anything else you want to say.
Yeah, but I mean, in relation to my own experience, was that I got poorer and poorer. And I kind of was doing more and more work for Liberate Tate, and then kind of when we did talks, the money from the talks was going to Liberate Tate, so you're kind of not earning any money from the labour, but then no one really employed you for anything. So that was kind of one effect of it. And then there were kind of other things like, you know, all these different proximities. Like when I started it, I was working at Chelsea, which is right next to Tate Britain. Of course, whenever I went over to Tate Britain with my students, to have a talk there or go to a coffee, kind of I'd be eyeballed by security. Or like, you know, psychologically, like was my website hacked by Bitcoin or was it hacked by BP? Or, you know, what, you know, when you kind of realise that you've been photographed by the Metropolitan Police and your photograph's been circulated to security across the whole of London. All the kind of galleries that are kind of sponsored by BP. So there was this kind of other kind of psychological kind of thing that happened. There were people, I remember going to a friend's memorial and it felt like I was like this kind of electric eel and everyone was sort of turning away from me as I kind of moved through the room because Nicholas Serota was there. So there were these kind of like wider kind of sort of macro and micro kind of ways that the power of the Tate was kind of this kind of institution was being kind of exerted or transmitted in some way. So those were all very real and kind of very kind of happened for a very, very long time. But I think maybe within that kind of sphere, it might be worth saying that there are amazing and wonderful things that happen, like, you know, things like the security guards at the Tate. One time we finished and they said thank you to us on the way out. Another time we were kind of when we were in the turbine hall when we stayed for 25 hours, one of the members of Liberate Tate said to security, thank you for staying up. And he said back, we did it together. So, you know, and kind of there were these amazing, beautiful, beautiful moments of kind of shared experience, sort of feelings of love after doing, you know, kind of for each other after having done those things and taken those risks. So it's a kind of range of experiences and a kind of discovery of other people, of different people, of people that actually were supportive, you know, and weren't the people that turned their back. So, you know, there is kind of that sort of lived side of it, I think, is something that was quite very real for me.
Yeah. The other question that I really wanted to ask as well is the sense of, you know, who owns the art world? Who owns the sense of the public art world? I think that the complexities of trying to map who it is who, you know, who may be investing in the various machinations of the market is something quite complex and could be pursued. But in terms of these public spaces, we kind of do know who owns them because, you know, it's the state and it's local councils and it's the institution that funds them. And I suppose that one of the most obvious issues here, you, you, you've raised it, is this question of what is the real policy that these institutions are using in order to fund their activity, and to what degree is there any real diligence in terms of due process? And what I mean, obviously, Liberate Tate has been fantastic because it's shown what you can do, what victory might look like. But the longer term implication is something much more complex, because it does demand that institutions really reimagine the sense of what will fund what they do. And this is a massive political car crash, because essentially, since the Blair government, we've been looking at the creative industries, we've been looking at cultural entrepreneurship, we've been looking at all of these models of partnership funding, which actually predefine the space not as public space, but as privatized space. And it seems to me that there's definitely a lot of work needs to be done at a government level, at an institutional level, to look at the implications of cultural policy. Is that something that you...
Well, I don't know. Yeah, maybe. Yeah. I can speak to it, but I don't know if you want to hear it. No, I just think, like, we can't be like, yeah, it's because of the Labour government. It's been happening since we got enfranchisement. Obviously, the state has been like, in 1928, when we could all vote, they were like, how are we going to change this? Like, they're just going to vote in a socialist government. So we have to sort out a way of making people think that that's not what they want something else. So I think if you actually look throughout history, if you look even at the first instance of the Arts Council, like the best for the most, like the motto, that's also like the albatross around the neck, or the anchor that makes everybody drown afterwards, because it's kind of a totally unworkable model. And it gets changed subtly over time and articulated in a different way. But it's still, what's the new Arts Council motto at the moment?
Great art for everyone.
Yeah, it's the same thing. It's the same thing. And okay. So basically, you can even talk about Thatcher coming in and sort of really kick-starting the privatisation of public institutions by doing a lot of business and art sponsorship initiatives that really encourage businesses to give money. But all of this stuff has sort of been written, you know.
You specifically talked about conservatism, and there is a creeping conservatism in the kind of programming and activity within the public realm of the galleries, and that is a consolidation of a sense of the need to balance the books, as it were. And
I'll tell you where
balancing
that,
the books, what
no, I tell you where that comes from. That comes from the need to really make the British art world punch above its weight. That's where that comes from, because blatantly, you remember a time when England wasn't really, you know, in the world scheme of things, we weren't really that amazing. You know, London wasn't the global financial capital that it now is. It also wasn't the global capital of arts that it now plausibly could feasibly be argued that it is. And I think that there was a moment where people, like Nicholas Sirota, maybe people like Sandy Nairn as well, had good intentions, and they were like, how do we change this? How do we... And I think the Turner Prize is an interesting thing to look at as well, because the pre and post 92 Turner Prize is a real good indication of that shift. Before 92, it was this dusty affair of mostly blokes, like Matthew Collins got an opportunity. I think that's like Matthew Collins was nominated, some director. It was just a random thing. And then they got Channel 4 involved, and they're like, this needs to be a cultural moment. Everybody has to be talking about it. It has to be about British identity. It was like a brand exercise. And after 92, Channel 4 funded it every year for about 8 or 9 years, I can't remember exactly. But you can see there's a concerted effort at the beginning of the 1990s to make art into this amazing, this thing of becoming the cultural industries as opposed to, like, I don't know, small things of, like, cultural production. But the problem is, at the same time that they're doing that, government is also doing their agenda to make London the global financial capital of the world. So it's almost like art is the ornament that's garnishing the, like, I don't know, the turd of tax avoidance, oligarchy, preparing the way for land banking homes, as if this was a random thing that happened, that suddenly we're in a city that costs more than most places in the world to live in, where university fees cost £9,000 a year, where studios cost a ridiculous amount of money and they're closing all the time. but we've got more oligarchs than ever living in this country. Why are they here as opposed to Dubai? Well, because we can argue that we've got this amazing infrastructure of cultural initiatives. Not only do we have the Tate Modern, we've got all these other galleries, and you know what else we're doing? London Borough of Culture, just in case you didn't have enough. And I just think this, like I totally understand the idea that our galleries are struggling and that, but I think there's a larger narrative, which is this heroic one, which is people trying to sort of reinvigorate the art world, but then just keeping going with that strategy. It's like there might have been a moment where it was really like it was balanced, like we were having more galleries, and there was a grassroots, plausible grassroots. There's private money, and we're sort of on an even keel. But now, private finance has the whip hand, man. If you're a curator, it's about your collector base. It's about who you can encourage to the institution. And I think the reason is because they just went along with that model. That's my thesis. I don't have any stats to back it up, but it's a plausible one, I think.
I think, again, I mean, the other interesting thing in terms of this table and its fantastic decoration, which is edible, distributable, and available to it for anyone to take and give away, is that we obviously did invite some people, I suppose, who are more obviously on the moneyed side of the art world, and they declined to come. And I think that that's, again, part of the problem of the who owns the work, the art world, and how you engage with the anxiety around the ethics of the way it engages, is those people who are responsible for controlling this shift in policy, or who have significant capital investment in art washing their profiles, also are very quick to disappear when you actually ask them to articulate what value they think they are bringing to the equation. And that's again one of the kind of the problems of the media. So, you know, when Morgan says, you know, what are we going to do? It's because, I suppose the question here is that certainly as artists, you both feel that the only thing to do is to actually take direct action.
Well, I think it's not that straightforward. Sorry, Richard.
Well, sometimes it's important to take direct action, but sometimes it's important just to, like, ignore stuff. Like, the art world is kind of, like, whatever. It's like a desperate bunch of lame galleries and desperate curators and desperate collectors, and it's kind of some days feels very irrelevant and unimportant. So I think it's sort of about picking your battles and working out stuff like that.
But I think also there is an argument for withdrawal and for kind of more specific, kind of focused kind of points of engagement. And I think that artists, and I think that there is. I kind of feel like there might be the beginning of a kind of different, of a cultural change around kind of, you know, what we want as artists and also kind of what it means to be an artist. I mean, the thing about, you know, going to meet a curator and then going for dinner and then talking about a project, it's so boring.
It's so weird.
It's just not exciting. And there are kind of really kind of interesting things that we can engage with and do and kind of make and contribute to and that are really kind of vital and important. And I think that those models are boring and old and kind of deadening to the soul in some way.
Can I just, yeah, just to, I think, yeah, I totally agree with you, Hayley, and I think, just to go back to that thing I was talking about, that heroic narrative of like re-energising the art world, I think because they were actually battling with a kind of old stark conservatism, of which you could say Brian Sewell was like a paradigmatic example. Now he's gone now, but we've got other like neocon type critic type, so Jonathan Jones or Valdemar Janáček, who say, why don't we have more YBAs in the Tate? Why is it not into... So anyway, but... I think what you're saying about like the cultural change thing is really important because I feel like in some ways art history is so obviously exists in the past, but I also feel like more often than not a lot of artists who are sort of emerging or coming up now or even quite established are drawing on subculture or drawing on cultural production that's happened post 1960, And so in a way, the moulds and forms that we have in the art world, let's say medium moulds and forms, so you've got sculpture, video, discourse, action, relation, whatever, these are all useful, but then the subjects, discourses and debates that people are pushing into them are new. And so there's a disconnect whereby you have cultural capital that comes from somewhere else, but then there's this weird discord between an institution that is trying to reference that to art history, or is trying to pull on art history to validate or invalidate what you're doing. And I feel like that tension is just going to become more and more pronounced. And at some point, people are going to be like, what is the point? Why do we, or do we want to be associated with this? Do we want to be associated with that? So even you can look at like new media and like internet art, that is still has a vexed relationship to institutions. And I feel like at some point, maybe now we're at that point, people are just like, well, what does it matter? But I'm not trying to say we should just totally relinquish them, because they're art.
Yeah.
Same as Arts Council England is arts, it's part of the welfare state package. So.
Yeah. But it's about making it like the culture different in some way.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think, and really kind of thinking through kind of who we are. Like, you know, for example, like having kind of environmental consciousness, I want to make work that kind of with materials that has really low impact. I don't want to kind of like kind of keep contributing by kind of making stuff with plastic or just things like that, that you know, just a kind of little points of resistance that might kind of open up a different culture.
Yeah. So and again, I suppose thinking about the ways in which artists are likely to contest this kind of ownership of the art, I mean, I suppose the things that I think about, I suppose, it is the question about collectivity and the way that collectivity has been exploited as a notion, particularly kind of, yeah, I suppose collective identities of, as you're saying, of this collection, but also I think in relationship to the projects such as the Artist Pension Trust, the notion of that is collective, I think, is an exploitation of that term. And I think that the other way to think about this is about the kinds of disturbances which artists have made, which are fundamentally effective. So apart from the direct political intervention in relationship to the gallery, Bob and Roberta Smith, and I think that the campaign around the art and the A level, and about the fundamental question about where, you know, artists sit and art sits within the curriculum, I think is a fundamental one, because I think, again, the other question is, in terms of artist practice, the whole role, half of London on strike, because, you know, the role of artists in education is fundamentally under attack, and I think that that's another layer of discourse where artists can actually make a difference, because they are always very canny communicators. But
don't you think this is all about agency? So it's basically the institution has the power, the institution is setting an agenda, and it's no, like...
Well, I think there's more to life in institutions. I think it's a trap to sort of...
No, I'm not saying that. This is the problem in talking in these terms, because it sounds like I'm just black and white. But I'm saying they set the agenda. Like at the moment, who's going to have the voice of people making cultural policy? It's going to be institutions, right? So what I'm saying is, now that if you think about the art world, people will go straight to Tate, or they'll go straight to this or straight to that, rather than there's a powerful lobby of artists who actually. Practice is moving at such a high rate, people don't really know what's going on, you know? I feel like there's been a shift in the balance. And I'm not sort of saying we have to always look to institutions, but I am saying, well, obviously, if there's an agenda being set, it's being set by people who occupy those positions, because it's going to be, what's her name? Maria Bauschel is the one who's going to the palace and not me. I mean, it's a fact. She goes to the, like, what's the point in having the director of Tate go to the palace? We can't pretend that this isn't a class-ridden society. That at the top of it, there's a monarchy who's supposed to be ordained by God. These have effects, and like, artists, for some reason, like, and it's not. I think it's not just artists as well, is it? Because also for a curator, it's a debased position now. Like, you're the one who has to go out there and chat to people and shield someone over here who might be wanting to be radical, but then you've got to take all of, you know, so everybody's involved in this, like, system that's kind of off-key. And I think just to go back, you know when you're saying about risk and that, like, this might sound a bit random because it's just something I wanted to say earlier, and I was like, oh, maybe I can shoehorn it in now. But, like, you know, there's a story by Franz Kafka, short story called The Starving Artist. I don't know if anyone's familiar with it. Is anyone familiar with it?
No.
All right, okay, so basically it's a story about, they go to like a freak show fair, like P.T. Barnum thing, and there's a guy in a cage, and he's a starving artist, and people come and watch him starve. And like, after a while, the starving artist attraction is no longer pulling the crowds in. And at the end of the story, just before he's about to die, because he's so emaciated, one lone person comes along with their kid and says, I really admire what you're doing, you know, it's so amazing, this is a lost craft and, you know, you're the best. And then he walks away and the starving artist has this moment of shame because he's like, well, not a moment of shame, but he just feels like, well, like, what he doesn't know is I hate food. Like, I don't want to eat, you know, like, it repels me. And I'm like, you know, sometimes if people say what you do is heroic if you're trying to oppose a system, right? But it's just like, how can you be involved in that system? It's like an aversion to it. Like, and I feel like questions about risk and like what might be and whatnot, I feel like maybe they don't even come into it because when you notice the disparity, the hypocrisy and the contradictions that are riddled within this system of like magazines, galleries, markets, you know, blah, 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 it gets harder and harder to just not do something. Sorry, that's a transgression, that was a, sort of digression, sorry. But
it's not a digression because it's about what motivates you, and it's about the energy, and I think that kind of sense of passion and energy is something which is something that you maybe want to channel and focus, or you maybe say to yourself, no, I cannot channel this any longer because it's going to destroy me. But so I think it's that's not a risk, you know, because it's, to not do it would destroy it.
But we're in a different phase now, you know? Like, you think about the occupations and you know, everyone's always talks about Hornsey? You know, the Hornsey, the art school thing, we knew, you know, that's amazing. And Warwick as well, you know, they occupied Warwick. And they were threatened with court, you know, appearing in court, and it never happened. But it happened to Central St Martin students. I was in court with them. And then I went to interview a collector, and a cleaner opened the door in a pinafore. I was like, people actually have people who wear that. And then I went to the ICA and it was a show by Odessa Henderleys and there were security guards everywhere. And you just think, this isn't just an odd circumstance. It's a world that you can either be complicit in or try to oppose in a productive way. And I'm just like, that's like the thing, I don't want to eat that food, you know?
So, Richard, are you going to eat the table of the art world?
Yeah, well, I'm hungry, have a bit, but, you know, it's on my terms. I think, yeah, pretty much most of the time. And then sometimes yes, sometimes no. But I just don't want to have this sort of, like, Oedipal thing about the man or the art world and that, like, distracts from my mission of doing art.
Yeah. Hayley?
What was the question? Well,
the question is, are you going to continue eating at the table of the art world?
I guess, I'm interested in making art, and I want to continue making art, and I don't know what the art world is, in a way, in this kind of...
It can be your own art world, though, sometimes.
But yes, I think, you know, in a way it is my own world that kind of, that is the place that I like to be.
I suppose fundamentally the question though is in terms of eating at the table of the art world means that you understand that the sustenance as an artist is going to be somehow connected with your capacity to sustain yourself and sustain your practice. And how do you deal with it if that food is poisoned? I mean, I think that's in terms of the ownership of the art world. I think that I don't think that Morgan is alone, and I don't think you're alone. In thinking that it does feel slightly poisoned, and yet sometimes a poison can be, a kind of the pharmacon can be something that takes you to an elsewhere, which is, you know, transcendent, transgressive, and to somewhere where you reimagine where you are. But the fundamental thing is, if you then wake up the next day and you're in the same place, it's not a good place. Now, I'm hoping that there's some questions in the audience, and more fundamentally, that someone sitting at another
space entirely may have come online to ask us some questions. So can I have an immediate question maybe from the audience?
Yes. I think there's one thing, a kind of basic question that I think it's important for you to address from my perspective, which is, why is it such a bad thing that the art world is owned and dominated by private finance? You haven't really spoken, touched on it a little bit in slightly elliptical ways about what the effects of that is. What is lost? What are the effects of what's happened? And a kind of what you were speculating about, I mean, I think the most graphic example of what's happened is that 10, 15 years ago, the balance of funding for Tate was 70% public, 30% private. That has now entirely flipped to 70% private and 30% public. And I think the question of what the effects are of that, why should we be concerned, why should we act?
Because the Tate will get even worse. But maybe it should get worse. Maybe it should just be a crash.
I mean, see, it's interesting in terms of thinking about that private investment and what the ethics of it are. Because, you know, so for example, one artist group who've been doing a lot of work around the Golden Main Estate, a lot of the activity there was evidently in the estate, banners, etc. And then they've gone and done an exhibition in Raven Row, which is famously owned by one of the wealthiest families in the country. And so this kind of sense of that, yeah, there's always going to be a tension there about what it is you're saying and then how it is framed.
For me, I would say that art comes from a very kind of private space, a kind of private space that connects from to the social, and is, you know, it's kind of it's very personal, but it's also political and public. And I think that there's something in connecting that, or kind of allowing that to be framed by a kind of company that has human rights kind of issues, let's say, is really difficult. I don't want that. I don't want my work to be framed in that way. And I would rather not be present in that space than have that kind of have that company kind of frame this thing that I've made. So for me, that is a kind of very, very kind of personal position. I just I don't want.
So, I mean, you'd have to do like case by case. Sorry, it's a really irritating expression, case by case basis. But like a really simple example is like, say, the Freelance Foundation, for example, is this initiative that happened a few years ago, and it was designed to, I think it was to support the art of female artists. But, you know, what if you happen to be critical of like the Murdoch media empire, and then whoops, his daughter is the one who's funding Freelance Foundation? Could there possibly be a tension, explicit or implied, for you to maybe not do that? Or would you even be considered for the opportunity in the first place? Now, that might have some ramifications if we pull that out and we look at all these different other opportunities that are designed to give somebody a leg up. If they're all similarly funded in similar ways, then what happens is you start to get quite a narrow vector for acceptable practice, which then has a knock-on effect on what people are producing, and then it has a knock-on effect on what discourse is being discussed, and then it has a knock-on effect on who's going to be employed in institutions. So you have sector homogeneity of discourse, and then you have, well, them two things, which are bad enough. But then I'd also say, then it's like a and maybe it's a question, maybe a personal moral question, right, for somebody. So, like, I'm not against, this is the other thing, I'm not totally against private finance. Like, what, you know, that wouldn't make any sense. Like, I, you know, someone could have a flat and be like, oh, I've got a bit of profit from it, I'm going to give you some money. That's kind of private finance. Or they could have a plumbing company and they're like, I want to sponsor you. Or if anyone's like over 35, you remember like when Khan's like Curry House sponsored your local cinema, you know? Like, now that's a different thing to BAE Systems sponsoring the Great Exhibition of the North. Now, people have short memories when it comes to corruption, but in the 1980s, there was something called the Al Yamama deal, which was the biggest arms deal in history, I think. And it was between the UK and Saudi Arabia. And like, some people call it the Hoosier Mama deal because Mark Thatcher was big in that. And anyone who knows Mark Thatcher knows that that guy was so corrupt. And it's like, it just doesn't stop there. That stuff goes into like international arms trade. What was happening with Charles Taylor in Liberia? That this stuff is serious. And you just think, why? Who is yoking together creative expression with like destruction of human life? I mean, that's like a basic thing. Just that as a concept is questionable. But then, when you actually look at what actually happened in these times and start pulling it out and figuring out what's going on, it's just like, it's crazy. So that's why I would have issues with it. And those are just like basic off-the-cuff examples. If, you know, we could surely pull out loads more, but there'll be some people out there who are happy to do that. And that this is, I suppose this is my lobby in a way. It's like, go for it. I'm not gonna try and convince you to do different, but I'm not doing that. I don't wanna do that. And I feel like art, you know, the thing that drove the 20th century was the avant-garde, right? Now we can all say, yeah, okay, it was racist, sexist, and all of that. It was, definitely. But just that initial energy of being iconoclastic and breaking with art history, all for the rest of the century. Now, what are we offering now? That's the issue. What are we giving birth to at this moment? What possibly could be the rest of the 20th century, 21st century? And I feel like, in some ways, I'd like to throw myself under the bus or whatever to give a shot of something possibly happening in the future. So that's why I kind of like, sometimes I feel like I'm writing something, because if I write something, that offers a discourse, right, in a way. So those facts and figures are out there, so a student can talk about them without fear of reprisal because they're just in public circulation. So, yeah, that's why I'd say private finance is not such a great thing. When it's linked to companies with questionable moral ethical practices and no qualms about exploiting people through sort of neoliberal loopholes and all the rest of it.
Another question? Do we have any questions online?
Not yet. I guess it's comments about, there's a few things that when you guys have said that's in my information, this idea of as an artist, like the distraction of this discussion and how your work sits within that frame, and this idea of like an industry or a kind of art world or a system that you either kind of opt into or opt out of. And it's, I think, on a day-to-day basis as an artist, you're kind of confronted with those questions and decisions about how you operate and what your kind of ethical stance is, and what's your contribution, I suppose, like that is a bigger question, like what's my contribution in the world, and where does that kind of reach out into? And it's really difficult, I think, to navigate through that. And I was just wondering if you had any thoughts around that.
Around navigating the...
Yeah, and I think particularly as a sort of new career in artists, I don't know, that's even
artists.
Work. Yeah, and emerging, yeah. Work, you know, it's sort of strange,
yeah.
Arbitrary kind of thing first, but because obviously, you know, this idea of agency as well, and the value of who you are and what your work is and what you're saying, or do you have to say anything, or does it all need, you know, all these kind of big questions that I think are really, really important. but very confusing, especially when you're quite new to it all.
I think that's it though, it's confusing, and that's good, and that's the way it is. And like in my experience, I'm pretty much confused all the time, and that's okay. I've been in sort of funny positions to private finance and public, the opposite of that. And the work I do sort of gets me in and out of these things to a greater and lesser extent. And I've never really, well, I try not to rely too much on the kind of fictions or the art world myths or this, like when you're kind of come out of art school, there's this weird feeling that there's a collector watching on the internet like 20 feet away wherever you go, and it's a weird sort of paranoia that it's not helpful, so I just, yeah. Also, I like working with other artists as well, so, yeah.
And in that sense, I suppose the conversation with other artists is really important, again, going back to that question about DACS and artists for artists, actually the network of artists in the sense of, can we do this as a kind of paradoxical intervention? If I do a show at Bloomberg with elephants, you know, is that going to be good or bad? And you sit with other people and you can explore the efficacy of your situation?
Sometimes you just let people slack it off and stuff. And that's good too. Yeah, equally valid.
I think in an intergenerational capacity, I have to recognise that I have a privilege of a job, kind of a part-time job in an institution, kind of teaching, and I can earn money that way, and I can kind of support myself that way. So I think that there is, there are inequalities there, kind of intergenerationally as artists. I think kind of from kind of my position now, kind of approaching 50, I kind of think that I want to kind of personally challenge ideas of this sort of formed role that we all have kind of as artists, and like how our behaviour is kind of, I think our behaviour is more and more shaped by the institution actually, in terms of kind of questions around professionalisation and those things. And actually maybe there is, having come through that, actually there is a, there are other ways of doing it and other ways of kind of making the work that you want to make. So I think that's sort of where I would be in relation to that.
Is it all right if I?
Please do.
Yeah, so one of what's interesting is that, since the 1-2 punch of Brexit and Trump, I can't remember what way around it was. But now politics is like the hot topic, Like, you couldn't really get arrested if you were trying to do anything vaguely political before, but now it's like everyone, it's almost like you have to have some sort of issue. And so, sometimes when I meet younger artists, occasionally going to schools and doing tutorials and that, it's really, it's people earnestly, young people are really earnestly saying, what do I do? What shall I, do I have a responsibility to say something about something? And, I suppose that's an individual decision that each person has to make. But one of the things I think it's important to keep in mind is that, you're not obliged to make artwork about social, cultural, political or economic circumstances. It's okay for you to just live in abstraction too. Because in a way, that's kind of what we're fighting to allow you the freedom to do. So more often than not, I feel like that's a question about how do I become engaged because I'm concerned. And I don't necessarily think you have to do that through practice. You can just do that through action. And that might actually free you up for your own sort of practice. And then you figure out, because this is the thing as well, isn't it? You're like, I don't like doing research about tax evasion or reading about arms dealers and all that. Like, I hate it. It's so, like I was saying about the guy who killed himself. It's really depressing. I'd rather be looking at, like, what happened with minimalism, really? You know? And I think we shouldn't... There's something amazing and magical about art, isn't there? And I feel like one of the reasons that I stay close to it is because being close to, like, the imaginations of artists has really opened me up to things that I would have not encountered if I hadn't have had that relation to artworks, pieces of music, maybe even clothes. And I think that has a kind of subtle political power, which is about giving you something, helping you to move through the world. But then there's another thing, which is this system where you have to sit down and sift through data and identify this and what's this group. And sometimes that can be liberating for someone in their practice, but it can also be really a straitjacket and a bind. So I don't know, I feel like I always say to them students, like, it's up to you, choose, see what you like, you know, see what the vibe is, because it's not easy, and sometimes you'll be more effective just going directly to the thing that you want to address. Like, for example, rough sleeping. It's increased 120%. This is the new crisis report. 120% since 2010 to now. I might be slightly off, but I'm not off on the percentage. I might be slightly off on the date spread. But it's that you can download the crisis report now. So would you make more of a difference doing a piece of work about it, or just going and figuring out how you can organise and help someone, and then figuring out what you want to do with your practice? So, that's probably what I'd say.
Which sounds very rational, I think. Unfortunately, that is... Oh, hold on.
There's actually one
question. Go on.
All right. So we do have one question from Periscope. Jean Val said, what is the panel's view on artists making a sustainable living from creating digital work?
Sorry to hijack in, but could we also, there was a question out there as well. What if we just heard that and then addressed both of them? And if there's another one. It's like, this is the bit, isn't it? This is the powerful bit, and it always gets cut off.
Thank you. Well, my question actually picks up from what you are saying. I want to make a stance for the work of art, because the work of art is separate from the artist. And the work of art actually can be disruptive and can be sort of a conduit for a different scenario. So the work of art is something we shouldn't forget in all of this.
I agree. I don't think it's an either-or situation.
Yes.
I think it is about kind of a kind of whole, like, of being able to kind of, be in all of these positions, actually. And I think that's a very rich space to be in.
Yes, because the art object can be extremely powerful.
Yeah, but it's just, sometimes it's like, it doesn't have to be a detrimental description. You know, if you say, like, yeah, art can be really powerful, but see, when you say but, people think you're like, oh, you're trying to discredit art, and it's not, but it's just saying... Yeah, because you're just sort of saying, that art can be a really powerful, like, for me, like, things have happened to me because of artworks, but, you know, when you're, like, trying to tackle something specific, it almost, you need a different type of energy, but maybe art is the thing that gives you the sustenance to do that.
I completely get it, but there ought to be different artworks, so not just actions for artists, but different artworks being produced.
Yeah. What was that question?
The other question was, what's the panel's view on artists making a sustainable living from creating digital works?
That drew a very deep breath. Probably quite complicated, but it's interesting because it also draws in the question of social media.
Well,
and social media politically, in terms of artistic discourses, is something which is very, very much alive.
But it also... So, is that okay for you? So, this is the other issue, isn't it? Like, what are you doing as a citizen? Because if you really think about, you know, if you really think, okay, so, you know, people think about slavery and they say, how can people live and be, like, okay in England or where, what other colony, when they knew elsewhere there was people who were being treated as, like, were slaves, basically? How could that happen? And in a way, I don't want to be, like, hyperbolic, but in a way, so we've got a similar situation at the moment. Like I'm happy I can walk around, but at the same time, my consumption has been fueled by the production elsewhere that is happening under strained circumstances. So I think the thing with digital that I don't think has been grappled with enough is, like, what's the real world footprint of, like, the immaterial thing? So I think, yeah, maybe people can make alternative ways of living, but the flat screen that you're using, the industrial footprint of the data that you're using, that's going into some sort of storage center, you know, these have consequences, some in the Congo, some elsewhere. So I think it's hard because everything is it has implications. So I'll be like, yeah, make a living, but there's, you know, it's not totally free from stuff that's happening.
And at that point, unfortunately, we're going to depart. Thank you to Richard, Hayley, Quaintance, and
Morgan,
and to questions from outside. Thank you.
Thank you.